Welcome back from the break. This is the Business Show. Now, for so many years, government has been advocating for value addition as it's the only way that you can make more because you are not giving out just raw materials. This week on How to Make Money, we speak to a young man, Cyrus, from Butambala, who is dealing in ginger and is adding value to the same ginger. He says he has never thought about getting employed as soon as he started adding value to his product.
My name is Chigundi Silas. I'm the team leader, Chibajo Enterprises.
Okay.
So Chibajo adds value to ginger into finished product. You know, for all the generations, most of our ginger has been exported to other countries, but those people come and buy it here, even Kenyans, at very, very low prices, and now take it, add value on it, and bring it back in finished products. Like powdered foam, and they sell it expensive to the Ugandans, yet even the farmers were cheated. And as Cyrus, who grew up in Butambala, as early as 3 years, I was taking care of ginger on the ginger farms of my family. So my dad and my mom were all peasant farmers. No one had ever gone to school. Yep. They were doing ginger.
Okay.
And now like another life started in July 2002 when my dad got an accident. So he got an accident and all his limbs got damaged. He could not do any more farming. So all the money he could get from the ginger after being cheated by the middleman could support taking him to Mulago for the nursing payments, for reviews, and also buying the necessities, food, kerosene for the third over at home, and all other those basic necessities.
Okay.
Yeah. All so, right. Now, what I had to do is to take care of on other people's farms so that to get the school fees to reach high school.
Okay.
Now, when I reached high school, I had no more money to go to university. And then I started trying to see how I can achieve my dreams even before going to university. And I decided to become an entrepreneur. And now creating a solution, supporting farmers from my ginger growing region.
Okay, so it kind of sounds like you don't have to really go through university to be an entrepreneur or to be successful or do something that is tangible in society. Because look, your story is a bit touching from the start, but now let's talk about how then, from a young boy that was growing up on the farm, you know, watching over the ginger grow, how did you get the idea to start adding value, and how was it starting?
As I've told you, the farmers have been cheated by the middleman. And then when you go to the supermarket, you find ginger from Kenya, from Nairobi, a kilogram sold over 80,000. And this ginger is even not pure. They are additives, so after using it for 2 weeks, it's not pure. And I was like, it means if we make a finished product, but we as Ugandans here, but yet on it's based on fair trade, when the farmers are benefiting, and also Ugandans are getting this ginger at low prices, because the need is there.
Yeah.
Everyone uses ginger.
That's right.
If you don't use ginger for tea spicing home, you use it to make COVID concoctions. Because you remember previously,
yeah, you
add ginger with lemon and garlic, and then you make those immune boosters.
Yeah.
You know, people who cook home, like the mothers, the wives, they use it to make soups, to make different types of dishes. So ginger can be used like to do a lot of things at home,
okay,
and even at the industrial processing level to make biscuits, chocolates. So there was a big opportunity, and no one was coming to bridge the gap. And maybe they were waiting for the entrepreneur coming from the region who has the direct pain with the ginger farmers,
yeah.
Because I know what the farmers are going through by being paid of peanuts from the middlemen.
Okay, so I can see you're holding the one you started with, the one you started processing.
Yes.
So, How was that journey, starting with that small, ordinary, you know, processing and packaging like that? How was it?
So, this journey is very interesting, full of lessons and learnings. So, in April last year, 2021, I went back to Butambala. I talked to five farmers. about this amazing idea which I'm going to be building an inclusive value ginger chain in Uganda. Mm. And out of the five, three got intrigued and excited. Each gave me 20 kilograms of ginger, fresh. Wow. One. So I worked on the ginger myself and the mom. So I took the ginger to the water, to the well. I washed and removed all the soil, brought it back home, and now we cut it with the knives into slices for easy drying. Now on the tarpaulin. So after drying it, I got a local mortar.
Yeah.
You know Echinu, people use to make ginards, cassava flour.
Yeah.
And I also got the sieve, the local one people use. And now I sieved. So these small obuveras can be gotten like in Chiembe, or you know, I got these small obuveras. So I could, which people even use for other, these normal
products.
And then I was packing like 20 to 50 grams. And then first, I cited 15 people who could be potential customers from different groups, from the elite, working class, and the normal. And then I gave 15 people. And everyone was like, wow, what a product. What is missing is only the packaging. But we've never tested any pure ginger ever. I was like, I've been sitting on this golden opportunity all the time. So those people made even orders before I started producing. So now I had to look for other youths who could be interested, because my savings were not enough.
That's right.
I looked for other two youths. I told them about my vision, the golden opportunity, and also how we are going to be impacting the farmers.
Okay.
Not only getting money, but also changing their lives. So we raised some funds. Now we got a locally made machine for grinding. We also got some packaging, like first class.
Now I'm going to hold it at that first, because before we cross that packaging, how was it then for you trying to find, you said guys loved the other one and told you needed to improve on your marketing, I mean your branding.
On the brand.
How did you then improve, apart from just saying you got money from your other friends to improve this?
Yeah.
How was that journey, trying to ensure that now you make something better that can appeal to, you know, better clients than maybe the people in Butamba?
It was really of baby steps. From April, I launched Chibajo in July. It took me other 3 months to launch the product. By all that time, I was doing the grinding, trying to grind using different measures, and also giving to different people to tell me, is there a difference in quality? Is it the same? I also tried using these exotic breeds to see. And then the customers were like, no, we need the other first pure product. The one of Chibajo, because for to the farmers, Chibajo means the indigenous breed of that ginger. And now, after five people buying, they took and even gave to different friends. I have one of a friend from the heart, like, who was having a Mzungu lady. And then she was like, okay, now the product is good, but you need to get packaging. I started looking for different packagings, and they were not a bit top notch.
Yeah.
I wanted to make that final product, whereby you can find it in any supermarket outside Uganda, in Carrefour, in Mega, in Capital Shoppers, anywhere, and you can buy it, and it looks like an international product.
Okay.
So it took me more 3 months to get to reach to this perfect product.
So reaching to this perfect product, what lessons as a young entrepreneur did you learn from starting small to where you are? What are some of the lessons you learned that maybe someone watching could pay attention to and say, oh wait, I think I need to do ABCD before I go to EFG?
Okay, so as the vision bearer, someone who understands your idea, you need to know this from the beginning, that you need to involve yourself in doing the dirty work. I mean the first practical work. As I've told you, I had to go on ground, do everything so that I could have this the prototype, which I had to take to people for validation if the product is really good for them. And then even to the team, I had to, you know, to entice and intrigue them to come on board. I had to first have a product, you know, to show them that it's, you know, this thing is workable, it's profitable, you know, it's a product needed. I had to do research. So you have to involve yourself in doing research, especially on the market.
That's right.
Is the market really there?
Yes.
So after knowing that the market is there, because it makes no sense to make a product which has no market out there.
Yeah.
And then secondly, I've told you that I took it to to 15 people
to try
to tally, yeah, and you know, is this really important? That tells you that I really knew that I'm not making this product for me. Yeah, he was taking Chivajo in the raw form, but I wanted other people who don't have time to get a big stick, stone, mulao, and start pounding.
Yeah.
Yes, and I took it to them over 3 times to do the validation and tell me to improve. So you need to know that you are making this product for people. You have to listen to the customers. You are not your customer. The customer is out there. That's and then right. You make the product to them. Even the branding, even everything should be meeting the needs of the customer.
All right, so it's popular to say the customer is the king.
Yes.
And probably the lesson there for the people watching is always ensure that you're one, solving a community problem when,
yes,
you're starting a business, but also do not put your interest in your business so much. Whatever you're producing is for the people out, yep, there. So ensure that you meet their interests, not your interests. Now, what has been your turnaround when you upgraded to this other packaging now? What has been the turnaround for the business?
The turnaround has been very interesting.
Okay.
Because, you know, that customers mostly, in today's world, they buy packaging.
That's right.
Yes. So 70% of my customers buy because of the packaging.
But the quality must be good as
well.
At
first, some of them,
yeah,
they tell me, no, I bought your product because it was looking, you know, very nice. But do you know what is surprising and amazing? When I took it home, it is still now the best product. Because there's no ginger I've tested,
yeah,
which is pure. And even after using it for months, yeah, the purity does not decrease. It remains pure as if you bought it yesterday. So the packaging has also supported me,
yeah,
you know, to have a nice product,
okay,
and also take it out there. It speaks to itself. When you find it there, you know, you see it's rare to find, yes, these other products apart from coffee packaged,
yeah,
in
that package, that
you know,
good. That's right.
Yeah,
that's
so right. It's the top-notch packaging, mm, has also helped me to go even beyond.
Is it that expensive? Does it make the business sense for you? Very nice packaging. At the end of the day, when you compute how much you put in packaging vis-a-vis the returns, do you make break even as a business person?
We've not made the break even because we are 8 months old.
Okay.
Yeah, but we are making sales. Okay, it's a bit high.
Yeah.
But when you buy in bulk, it's a bit low.
But how does your projection look as a business person? So you have this, mm, now, you're saying, okay, if we can produce this, we estimate that this will be the sales and this will be the returns. Does it look clear to you where you're heading as a business person?
With the market expansion,
yeah,
which comes in, and even now, you know, we've been making sales for the past 8 months without even the UNBS. Now we are in the process of the certification of the UNBS because we are having the best product. A lot of customers, you know, there's my customer in Fiji. He was,
yeah,
like yesterday, you know, I'm your UNBS. If someone asks about the UNBS mark, tell them,
yeah,
I already certified. I have never tested any pure ginger powder like this.
Yeah.
The guy also does ginger growing, but he's no longer wanting to take the roots. The roots.
What's the process
now,
going?
He wants the process.
So I can imagine processing involves a bit of work as well. There's,
yes,
maybe there's electricity or something like,
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
How is the cost of production generally for a young entrepreneur like you?
Yeah, and before even the cost,
yeah,
we are currently employing 30 women in Butambala.
That is
who
the,
do
the entire
post-harvest.
Okay.
Who do the post-harvest, like from the washing of the ginger,
so that's from
to
the
cutting
garden
of the ginger,
yeah,
and the drying, because,
mm,
the drying takes like 2 weeks,
okay,
during sunny days.
Okay.
So you always have to cover it at around 5 and open it in the morning,
yeah,
and then you come and disintegrate it, like you don't leave it at one big piece. Yeah, not
squeezed.
Yeah.
A bit, so
spread it
a
bit.
Yeah.
Oh, so there are 30 women who does that when we are going when we are doing the post-harvest cycle.
Mm.
And then we also have like other 3 workers, part of the team, now where we are doing the processing.
Mm.
So after drying, we bring it to now Chitemu on Masaka Road, where we do the grinding, and now make this fine product.
Okay.
Yeah. And
operation costs
and
is
the operation
it, is
cost
it high?
It's not so high.
Yeah.
It would have been high,
mm,
but for me, it's more. It's advantageous to me because I don't need any middleman in the value chain. as I told you, I grew up in Butambala. I know the from the first one to the last ginger farmer. Mm. So I get ginger from Butambala and I employ people from Butambala. So there's no middleman amidst the whole value addition chain.
Okay.
So that supports me to eliminate a lot of costs which would have been getting within the middleman.
Okay.
But still we are doing a lot of costs in line with electricity, also renting.
Yeah.
But as you know, as we are progressing, the more the market expands, the more sales, and then we are able to cover those indirect and direct costs.
It's amazing how young people are out there making and creating jobs, especially in the agriculture sector. We hope that you picked a leaf from that and will have something to do for yourself. Now in Personal Finance, this week we start a month-long broadcast on financial planning and the essence of financial literacy with John Baptist Yewe, Team Leader, Business Banking, Standard Chartered Bank.
Good evening, viewers. You're welcome to today's show. My name is Yewe Johnny. I work with Standard Chartered Bank. I'm a team leader in our business banking department. Today, I'm proud to take you through financial planning and indeed the essence of financial literacy. Did you know that out of 100 people at retirement, 49% of these will depend on family and friends and charity? Did you know that 29% of these will be dead? Did you know that 12 will be broke? 5 will still be working, find reasons to continue working, prolong, and maybe change their dates of birth in one way or the other? Did you know that 4% will be financially independent and only 1 will be rich? Who will you be? So in this discussion, we are going to take ourselves through into what it takes to undertake financial literacy, be able to distinguish between needs and wants, borrowing, financial independence, wealth and investment. These are very critical areas that will help us to move our businesses and ourselves as individuals into financial freedom. So it is important for us to distinguish between a need and a want. A need is anything necessary for an organism to live a healthy life, and needs are sustaining. So you need that for you to live with as a bare minimum. However, a want is something nice to have. So distinguishing between a need and a want is very critical in identifying where you spend your money. Back in the days, one of the economic researchers, Maslow, was able to come up with a hierarchy of needs, starting with the basics at the base, which relate to physiological needs or the basic needs, then the psychological needs and the self-fulfillment needs at the epitome of the triangle. As human beings, it's very important that we take care of the basic needs, that is food, shelter, and clothing. And of course, as we progress, we come to certain levels of security. I want a lot, some of us nowadays talk of cameras, wall fences in our homes, all those among the basic needs, but at a certain level in terms of hierarchy. Then there goes a certain level where we talk of psychological needs, where we want to belong, a sense of belonging, into the lotteries of this world, into helping out, groups of friends. Some of us in the business community, we have our social groups, we have formulate and do business together. And then ultimately we have the self-actualization. Not many reach this need, but there are those loaded bourgeoisies we know around the world that end up even donating to the poor ones and taking care of them. So where are you at this moment in time? But it's important that you go through that hierarchy of needs and therefore organize your finances accordingly. I'll take you through a general life cycle of somebody who's a general employee or a human being. Many times, if you have been lucky to go to school, probably between age 1 to age 25, you'll be in college, and at that moment, you're depending on your parents' wealth. They're taking care of you. And probably after 25 or thereabout, you are out for the first job. Those who are lucky to go to school, those who are not unlucky, they start a little earlier and start in life in terms of taking care of themselves. Either they get married or get their first child, and so on and so forth. From that level, usually when you look at in terms of wealth and age, then your wealth starts to deteriorate when the first the family comes through and you have a child, you have needs to take care of, the need for you to have a reasonable home. And then probably if you are starting out working, then you start looking out for a change in job or career to try to meet your needs. At that moment, many times you are about 35 and you are hitting the bottom of the peak in as far as your wealth is concerned. You are living beyond your means at that moment, but it's a necessary step that you have to go through. Post that, if you are planning very well, you gain a bit of financial independence. You start taking care of certain things like insurance risks, health, start planning and investing. You start thinking of your family in terms of children, the schools they will go to. And where possible at that moment, again, you might undertake a bit of loans to organize your finances and your home and planning ahead. Some people at that moment consider even investing. They borrow to invest. And those who don't intend to be full-time employees, therefore plan out on their businesses at that age. In that cycle, probably about 40 or thereabout, you are looking at investing your wealth or accumulating, looking at how the future is going to be, both for yourself, for your family, and maybe starting looking into retirement, knowing that you will not have enough to take care of yourself if you don't plan early and now in life. At that age, usually again between 40 and 55, some of us or some people are lucky and they get a bit of inheritances. Of course, in today's world, many times parents don't leave enough for their children. Some parents can leave you with debt instead of where you expect to be, having property, all other things you take care of. So this session is very important, that as we plan for ourselves, we don't leave debt for our children. Instead, we plan to leave real wealth, things that will change their life, things that will change their generations, and we have to break such cycles. And probably post 60, it's very important that start to plan what we call retirement, but at that moment, you are already starting to consume your wealth. Your money should have been investing all along, should start to be working for you. You should be a loaded person who is spending most of your time recreating, taking care of your grandchildren. By that time, you've already taken care of your kids, they're out of school, and then basically enjoying life and taking care of your medical expenses, which usually tend to come with age. Until that time, when you leave everything to your kids and children and they take over from you. So we believe that the life cycle of a human being usually takes to go through that pattern, and it's very important that in each stage of life, you take care of it and plan accordingly.
Now, the Uganda shilling lost ground at the start of the week as demand for the hard currency by both the corporate and intermarket banks weighed hard on the local currency. Here now is a full report of the Forex and money market. It is said that the best way to tell the future is to create it. As a business person, if you are not getting most of the things in your business and business management right, it might be very hard for you to tell what is going to happen to your business in your business cycle and in the future. Make sure to always stay in touch with what you are doing and have books of records. Thank you very much for watching The Business Show tonight. My name is Viola Tasia. We'll see you next week. Good night.